Shall we pray? Bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for this evening. We want to thank you for bringing us all together. We want to thank you for all of the elected officials that are here and all the helpers and people that work for the county. We want to thank them, and Lord, just please continue to bless their lives. Please bless, of course, our cities of Fort Oglethorpe and Ringgold, and bless this wonderful county that we represent and we live in, Catoosa County. In your heavenly name, we ask these things. Amen.
Amen.
We salute.
Again, Ms. Tindall, thank you for getting together.
this time, we'll move to our right. Mayor Millwood, would you like to introduce everyone on here?
Yes, I'll start on this end of the table. We have Larry Black and Terry Crocker. This Councilwoman Sarah Clark, Councilman Randall Franks, and Councilman Jay Kings. And I also want to say thank you, Stephen, for your vision and putting this out there and for having all of us here. It's good to see that everyone on all the boards here. And, you know, we as elected members have, you know, vision sometimes. And I particularly want to say thank you to the people who make that happen in our government, starting at the top. And I'll introduce Dan Rod also. He's the one that we have vision. He helps make that happen. And also Jim and Jennifer, I appreciate all y'all done to help us get ready here today. And Ms. Reese. It's great to be here. I'm so happy to be here. This is a great opportunity for us to come together. And perhaps after all done, we'll hang out and talk a little while and just get to know each other a little better. And there's a lot to be said about that. It looks like everybody's here, and I don't guess we have a designated survivor, so we're all in attendance. I appreciate everyone coming in and for all this.
Thank you again for coming. And, you know, Jim mentioned it briefly. I want to thank Mr. Walker, Melissa Hannah, Laura Ogden, she's still in here for all our work with this together. And everybody that worked hard to get the presentation ready for tonight. So thank you again for doing that. Nick, it is when you have a vision, we forget sometimes that the people that make it happen. You know, their staff works hard for us, and I appreciate them doing that. At this time, I had one thing I wanted to share. One reason I always wanted to do this is, say, like every time I give a speech or a talk, I hear somebody say, well, I hope Capusa County gets it, or I hope Fort Overton gets it, or, you know, if it's progress coming in, or I hope Greenville gets it. One thing I want to make sure we all understand is no matter who gets it, we all win. We're all one unit. And if a county wins, we win. If a city wins, we win. But so many times through my short tenure, I've heard the separation, and that's one thing I don't like. But we're all one group, and that's the way we win. And I think we've got a good board. Earl mentioned that earlier. I think we've got a good bunch of people that are willing to work together. Thank you, Tom. At this time, Nina Reeves, I think the better way to start the show is to let you go.
Well, thank you very much for asking me to talk to you tonight. On behalf of our board chair, Mr. Guy Dykus, who had a trip planned at this time, I'd like to introduce our board. This is Jack Sims. Jack represents District 2. This is Susan Gibson. Susan represents, she is our at-large member. And Gloria Hunt represents District 1. And our vice chair is Mr. David Moeller, and he represents District 4. And I can tell you that there is no better board in the state of Georgia than the one that's sitting here in front of you tonight. So thank you for allowing us to be here. So tonight I'm going to briefly review our school system accomplishments. I'm going to share some celebrations, and I'm going to discuss our East Lost High projects, and then highlight some initiatives that we're planning for the future. 2016 was a great year for Catoosa County Public Schools. In this year, we were able to eliminate our furlough days. As you know, we began 5 furlough days back in 2011 after significant state budget cuts. We gradually were able to restore the work days as our funding increased, but this was the year that we were able to eliminate all furlough days. We're very fortunate to live in a community that sees the value of East Floss to provide educational facilities for our students. In March of 2016, we were excited to overwhelmingly pass East Floss 5. Proceeds from this Floss will benefit every school and every student in our county. The state of Georgia required school systems to choose one of 3 new governance options by June 30th of 2015. We chose charter system, and we used flexibility to implement innovative programs in our schools. Advanced Ed conducts rigorous on-site external reviews of school systems in the United States and 70 nations to ensure quality educational practices and continuous improvement. We earned continued accreditation by Advanced Ed as a high-quality school system. Next year, we will receive a 2% raise. This is the first time that the state has adjusted our salary schedule in 8 years. We will receive additional funding in each school as a Georgia charter system. We will continue to upgrade technology and infrastructure. We will improve safety and security in every school, and we will complete major facility equitability projects at Graysville Elementary, LFL High School, and Ringo Middle School. And I'd like to take a few minutes to share some of the awards and recognitions. To achieve excellence in operations, the Catoosa County Board of Education has earned the Georgia School Boards Association's exemplary school board status for the last two consecutive years. There are only 39 out of the 180 school boards in Georgia that were recognized as exemplary at the 2016 GSBA conference. The exemplary distinction marks the highest honor that any board of education can receive in the state of Georgia. And to achieve this status, the Catoosa County Board of Education met or exceeded GSBA's criteria for strategic planning, accreditation, compliance, and training. According to the Times Free Press Best of the Best poll, Catoosa County Public Schools is the best place to work in North Georgia. It is such an honor that our employees have chosen our system as best of the best place to work in North Georgia for the past two consecutive years. In addition to being selected as best place to work in North Georgia, our schools were selected as the best schools. Heritage High School won Best of the Best School, Boynton Elementary, and Ringo High School were also named in this category. We were very proud that the Georgia Department of Audits and Accounts has presented our system with the award of distinction for excellent financial reporting for the last two consecutive years. It's a high honor that only approximately 20% of the school systems in Georgia receive. The Catoosa County Chamber of Commerce chose our Partnership 2000 program as their 2016 Nonprofit of the Year. Partnership 2000 was founded in 1992 with 20 partners to improve our graduation rate. And in 2016, we have over 200 partners and 145 mentors in our schools. Significant accomplishments that contributed to the Nonprofit of the Year Award were our mentoring program, the Student Leadership Academy, and the Rising Professional Event for our high school students. We were honored that the Catoosa County Public Schools was selected by the Georgia Association of Educational Leaders to present as a Fab Four system at their recent winter conference. The theme this year was Growing Your Own. In our Let's Get Connected initiative, we had the opportunity to present how we were growing our own teachers as instructional technology specialists to prepare our students for the 21st century. One of our high school students produced an amazing video for this presentation, and I would encourage you to look at it on our website. I believe the awards and recognitions that we receive for excellence provide the foundation for high student academic achievement. In elementary school, our third through fifth grade students take the Georgia Milestones statewide assessment. I was very proud of our performance in this 2016-17 school year. Our students scored in the top quartile of all Georgia school systems on the Milestones assessment in fifth grade English language arts, sixth grade math, seventh grade English language arts, seventh grade math, and eighth grade English language arts, math, and science. On the Winter High School End of Course Test, our students scored in the top quartile in Algebra 1, Analytic Geometry, Physical Science, Biology, and U.S. History. And on the Spring End of Course Test, we were in the top quartile in 9th grade Literature, Analytic Geometry, and Physical Science. Everyone in our system understands that we have a responsibility for all students to graduate from high school. And from the time our students enter kindergarten until their last day of high school, we focus on graduation. In 2013, 78.9% of our students graduated on time. That number has steadily increased every year. And in 2016, our graduation rate was the highest ever at 85.5%. And you will notice that our graduation rate in red is always higher than the state's average in blue. I work with the graduation task force every month to make sure that we're providing the programs and services necessary to make sure that our graduation rate continues to improve. From our strategic plan surveys and our community engagement meetings in 2015, we determined that projects to enhance student safety would be one of our priorities for East Lost Wild. We are installing the Silos class system in every elementary school this year. This is a software system that enables teachers to communicate with administrators, law enforcement, and emergency responders. In the event of an emergency, we can silently dispatch 911 from a computer or a smartphone. We are the only school system in Georgia with a state-of-the-art security system. Surveillance cameras were installed in all elementary schools during Christmas break, and additional cameras have been installed in our middle schools and high schools over the summer. Some of our schools have already been rekeyed to the school system's exclusive patented lock system, and we continue to rekey locks during the summer. We evaluated our front door access in all of our schools. To improve security, we are installing a padlock lock system so that visitors must identify themselves before being allowed access to the building. Recess is an important part of the day for our elementary school students, so all of our playgrounds will be updated by the end of 2018. We've purchased and installed AEDs in every school system building, and we have purchased 10 new buses with the goal of purchasing 20 more over the next 5 years. The students in our classrooms today are digital natives. They've never experienced life without technology or the internet. To prepare our students for a digital and global economy, we must provide 21st century classrooms and utilize new teaching strategies. Rollout for our Let's Get Connected one-to-one technology initiative began in September of 2016 with 5,500 Chromebooks in grades 3 through 8 and continued with 3,000 iPads in grades pre-K through 2. And the final phase of this rollout will be complete when our high school students receive their Chromebooks with their schedules next week. High school students may use their Chromebooks at school and at home, and we've also upgraded our networks and infrastructure at every school. The Board of Education understands that facility equitability projects in East Wells referendums are a must, because parents want to know that their school that their child is going to attend is equitable to every other school in the county. Since the original section of Graysville Elementary School is over 65 years old, for safety and facility equitability, this school is being completely renovated. The picture on this slide shows the new section of the school that will be built. The middle section of the school will be renovated, and after the construction and renovation, the oldest section of the school will be removed. This project began in April, and it will be completed in the year 2018. Ringo Middle School is the only school in our county that has never had their own baseball and softball fields and facilities. If you've been by the Ringo campus recently, you've noticed that this project is well underway. The softball field will be finished this fall, and the baseball field will be completed in 2018. East Wells 4 funded an amazing performance gymnasium for Lakeview Fort High School, a visitor concession stand with restrooms, and lights on the football field. We've continued to upgrade the athletic facilities at LFO. East Wells 5 is funding the new home and visitor bleachers, the press box, and the new track. We've heard great comments from parents and community members about our East Wells projects. We understand it's important for the school system to use East Wells dollars wisely, so the community continues to support our SPLOS referendums. Next year, we are going to be participating in the REACH Scholarship Program. This is a state initiative to provide Georgia's academically promising eighth grade students with the academic, social, and financial support needed to graduate from high school, from college, and be prepared for work. To be eligible for the REACH Scholarship, the student must qualify for free and reduced lunch, and preferences must be given to students who are future first-generation college students. We will be one of the 41 school systems in Georgia participating in REACH. We get to choose 5 students per year. Each student will receive a $10,000 scholarship to attend college when they graduate. The REACH Scholarship may be used at the University System of Georgia, the Technical College System of Georgia, or an eligible private post-secondary institution. There are over 60 colleges that match or double match the scholarship, which increases the $10,000 award to a $20,000 or a $30,000 scholarship. The Partnership 2000 Steering Committee is going to oversee this program, and they will help us raise the $3,500 matching funds for the scholarships. We will choose our first students this fall. It's going to be very exciting for these students because they sign a letter of intent just like our high school athletes do. They will be paired with a mentor who will provide assistance throughout their high school years to make sure they stay on track. Our new graduation initiative is called Graduate Catoosa. Many of today's students have challenges and family issues, that make it difficult for them to attend high school. Additionally, the traditional high school model that you and I knew sometimes does not fit some of today's students. Working with our graduation task force, I believe we have programs to meet all of our students' needs. As you know, we have three traditional high schools, Ringgold, LFO, and Heritage. We have 29 different career, technology, and agricultural education, or what we call CTAE programs, to make sure that students are able to explore career options. We also have advanced placement or AP classes to prepare students for college. For students who need a more flexible schedule, we have the Batista Online Academy and the Performance Learning Center. Students in these programs participate in a computer-based curriculum. The Online Academy students have access to a lab of teachers, but they complete most of their classes independently. PLC students attend school every day, but they work at their own pace. Through Georgia's Move On From Ready program, students can dual enroll in high school and in college. This option allows students to get a jump start on college. They're really motivated, they can earn an associate's degree and their high school diploma. This year, we had three students earn dual degrees. A great advantage of this program for parents is that all of the college classes that these students took to earn that associate's degree were free. With our growing community, we know that current employers and businesses that you're trying to attract want to know that the school system is preparing the local workforce. Besides our employees, you are one of the first to hear our big plan for the future. We are planning a college and career academy for the year 2021. In Georgia, college and career academies are unique high school learning environments that provide opportunities for local communities to focus their educational resources on what's needed in their community. This means that our course offerings will be fluid, based on our community's needs. Our programs will be designed specifically to prepare our students for the jobs available in our community, and we can create new programs as needed to prepare students for jobs and new businesses that you attract to Batista County. Some training programs in Georgia's current college and career academies include engineering, biomedicine, technology, logistics, robotics, and many other fields that teach students the skills that they need to compete in our global economy. We're already working with the state to earn grant funding for this college and career academy, and the college and career academy will be a major project in East Law 6. So I'll close with one of my favorite quotes from Carl Blitman. He said that education is not public because it's publicly funded. Rather, it is public because of its public purpose. The school system is part of the infrastructure of a community. The quality of public schools has a direct impact on real estate values, unemployment, wages, and other economic factors. Healthy schools are an indicator of economic progress. The Board of Education and I understand that the quality of the school system plays a critical role in economic development in our county. We know our school system has attracted residents, and we believe that we have the workforce development program in place to attract businesses to Batista County. So ladies and gentlemen, I want you to be confident that Batista County Public Schools is prepared to be your economic development partner for the future. I want to thank you for inviting me to speak, and I look forward to working with you to improve the living conditions and the working conditions here in Batista County. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Reed.
Very informative.
Have another cycle where we're planning, or start the planning process on
And I'd like to discuss where we are. We're in the fifth cycle. We just completed the third year of the fifth cycle. So we're 23 years into the program. Starting in 1994, we collected $27.5 million. We're in the 2014 cycle now. After the third year, we have collected $29,000. Over the 23-year period, we've collected a total of $181,250,000. I'd like to show you the distribution of those, that $181,000. See at the top, you got Fort Overthorpe City, $43.3 million, 23.9%. Ringo is at $40,100,000, 22.1%. Catoosa Utility District, we collected $12,100,000, 6.7%. The EDA, Retirement of Indebtedness, 4.9%, 2.7%. The county has collected $80,918,000, 44.6%. Here's a graph that depicts those numbers. On the right, you got at right top, you got City of Ringo, City of Fort Overthorpe, 23.9. Below it, you got the Ringo at 22.1. Utility District at 6.7%, and EDA at 2.7. And on the left side, you got the county at 44.6%. We're currently in the 2014 cycle, which is fifth cycle. The referendum was for $60 million. We're currently collecting approximately 80% of budget. So we're looking at, we'll collect somewhere around $50 million in this cycle. It was distributed for over $12,150,000, 20.3%. Ringo at $9.9 million, 16.5%. Catoosa Utility, $2.3 million, 3.8%. And EDA, Retirement of Indebtedness, $6.7 million, 11.2%. Leaving the county $28,950,000, 48.3%. And then again, we've got the graph with the top right being Fort Overthorpe, below it, Ringo, Utility District, and then EDA at 11.6, with the county on the left side showing 48.3%. During the 20... During the 23-year period, the county projects for the $80,918,000. We had roads and bridges. We spent $20,000, 25.2% of our collections on roads and bridges and stormwater. Public safety, $16.5 million, 20.4%. Bent Place Campus, which this campus we own here, we spent $12 million, 14.9%. In recreation, we've spent 9.2%, 11.3%. The detention facility, 8.9 million, 11%. Public buildings, 4.4 million, 5.5%. Retirement of indebtedness, 4.4 million, 5.5%. And county equipment, $2.9 million, 3.7%. We had, in this period also, we had the expansion of the landfill for Site 2, which was $2.4 million, 2.9%. In the current cycle, the $60 million was distributed to the projects within the county. Oh, I'm sorry, the 28.9 million that was distributed to the county was roads and bridges and stormwater, 12 million, or 41.5% of the county allocation. Public safety, 9.5, or 32.9%. Public buildings, 3 million, or 10.4%. Recreation, 2.3 million, or 7.8%. County equipment, again, 2.2 million, or 7.5%. And in planning for this next cycle, we know that during this cycle, we've collected a little over 50, around 50 million. So we're planning on going for 60 million again. Over the next 7 years, we hope to be somewhere between the 50 and the 60 million dollars in collections. And it's time for us to start looking at projects and plan that process. Any questions?
Paper or police program. Unfortunately, of all of the people that are incarcerated, over 50% of my population has probation violations. So constantly, over 50% probation violations. Those could be failure to pay fines, could be other violations of law, but again, these are recidivist repeat offenders coming back into the system. So a work release program would be where someone would be sentenced to that program, and they would, we would help them become gainfully employed. They would leave every day, go to work, and part of their money would come back into the system. It would go through an accounting process where fines and fees and restitution would come out of their paychecks. Plus, we could charge them a slight fee for the work release program. Hopefully, during the evening hours, we could work with them, give them some more life lesson training, education, if they need further education, and just training how to better themselves. So, and this would basically be a band-aid to try to slow the need of another jail facility. I don't know if most of you know, I don't know if y'all, well, some of y'all were in office when I took office, but shortly after taking office, I asked the Sheriff's Association to come up and actually do a study on our jail. Because we were going into a squash referendum about that time, and we needed to know because our numbers were running, pretty high. So we needed to know if we needed to plan for it. So they look at how often we hold court, the population growth in our county, the types of crimes that people commit. And that study came back and said, for us to have another jail to last us hopefully 10 to 15 years, it needs to be able to hold 510 inmates. That's over double the capacity we're at now. So what we've been doing through these almost 5 years now that I've been in office was hopefully working with the courts, working with community programs, trying to push that back, trying to extend the life of that jail so that we're not looking at. You saw here with the splash that basically the jail cost us almost $9 million. But you couldn't build that jail today for $9 million. And there's no way we could build 510. Unfortunately, a jail has to be built at maximum security. It doesn't matter. We may have minimum and medium security inmates there, but it has to be built at the highest security level. And that's high dollar. That's about $300 a square foot. So you're talking a lot of money when you're talking maximum security. This type of facility, what I'm talking, would be more medium to minimum. So right now, just in some preliminary budget figures and talking to some consultants, we haven't gotten into a lot of facts, but basically a 100-bed facility, you're looking at about $3 million. So, and that's something that we've got to very seriously consider. If we continue to trend over our population, then there's a good possibility. We have some room, we have boats that we can put people in to help extend more beds within our facility, but there is a cutoff. And once we get that cutoff, then that means it may start having to be housed out. And then that starts getting costly. Very costly, because I don't know anybody locally that can even hold additional inmates right now. Most all the jails in our area are busted at the same. So that is a concern. Are there any questions or anything about the work release program or a work release facility that anybody might have?
Is there anybody that's tried that? Is it Floyd County?
Floyd County has one. Hammond County has a work release house. Bradley County just opened their facility. Yes, there's a number of different. There's all around the Atlanta area. Most of those counties have work release facilities as well.
It's probably actually going to help in release, I guess, get the condition to be out of
work. Right. And some of their money will then be, so they won't be given all of their money, so they can't spend it. So some of them will also be held back a little bit, so that when they are released, they've got a little bit to kind of hopefully go out and make a deposit on an apartment or something like that. But yeah, so this would be for child support. City courts could also send people there if need be, if they're someone that isn't gainfully employed. And we would work with local businesses to get them jobs, and or if the county had jobs for them, then it could be, they could be paid at a minimum wage and do county jobs. Yes.
Doing a 100-bed facility, do you know the hard numbers of staffing, what it would take?
You're looking probably about at least two on every shift, probably somewhere in the neighborhood of 12. Two officers and then somebody to manage the facility, and we will need somebody to be work kind of like a social worker with them, because a lot of them may need help getting their social security cards and things, documents they need to be able to get employed.
Is that considerably less than what it takes to staff jail and house?
Oh, yes, to manage 100 people, yeah, you wouldn't have to, just two officers for 100 people. Yes. And as long as we can keep it on the same property as the jail, then the current kitchen of the jail can help support this, so that's where keeping some of these numbers down. If we wound up having to build it somewhere else and put a kitchen with it, and laundry and things like that, then that could turn around and drive the price up. But we do have, I think, quite a few more acres there on the jail property that could possibly be utilized. So a couple of other things, if there's no other questions about work release. Yes?
I have a question about the cost. What's the cost per day of housing someone?
About $50 a day, in a regular jail.
And then being what ways in the work?
Oh, yes.
Sheriff, have you already got some business sponsors, businesses that said, build it, we will come?
Not as far as this, but I mean, with some of my other programs that we've already been working, I've already had two or three businesses that would come to us and say, hey, if you have an applicant that you think would work out, send them to me, we'll get on top billing. So yes, we have several companies locally, I think, that would work with us and more important. Any other questions? Couple other things about public safety, then if you would, if there's no other questions. Currently, right now, the public safety software that we use, as far as the sheriff's office, the local police department, Ringo Police, fire department, EMS, dispatch, is all different, and it's all older and antiquated. My software I've had since 1994. Some of the issues are our databases don't talk to each other. I give the Fort Police Department, the Ringo Police Department actually has remote access into my database, but I don't have access into theirs. So right now, if say I have a suspect, and I want to run him and see what kind of activity they've been up to, or has he popped up somewhere else on somebody else's database, I can't do that. And that's a problem. Currently, right now, my jail database doesn't talk to my enforcement database. And that's because it's older and antiquated. We need to upgrade our emergency software. Currently, our dispatch software doesn't push information out to our vehicles. And it needs to be doing that. That can save people's lives. There's information. If we're having a problem at a certain location, if fire EMS goes to it, it would be nice if we could be able to throw a flag up on it and say, hey, that person's not friendly to government. Or we've had problems here before, this person's known to carry guns. But we don't do that. So with that, I also propose that we definitely need to upgrade our records management software, and we as public safety need to come together and hopefully come up with one that we would all agree about, so that we could better share. Nowadays, that is a lot of what law enforcement and emergency services is about, and that's sharing information and sharing data. And right now within our own county, we do it by word of mouth, emails and such, but just simply querying someone's name, I don't know if they popped up in Ringo or the Throw Report or anywhere else. And that needs to improve. So for that, I would also ask, as part of SPLOSH, we had looked at this several years ago and had gotten some budgetary figures. Again, we don't have any solid figures. But for all emergency services to be upgraded, you would probably be looking at $1 million. But that would be your computer-aided dispatch, that would hopefully be your fire, EMS, all law enforcement, all talking together, all on the same kind of software, or at least making sure if they don't like all the software, then what software they have talks to each other. And currently right now, I know mine is a little bit older and antiquated than I think even what the city of Ringo is using. Therefore, it doesn't talk. And that's a problem.
Gary?
Yes?
That system tie in just locally, or would it tie into both to the state as well?
No, that would mainly just be locally. We can run people on a state database that then gets us more state information. But that would be really just here locally, what's going on in our communities. Any other questions about that?
The value of $1 million, that's many things, you're right. This is public safety that we're talking about and the safety of our officers. Are there other municipalities in our area or in the state of Georgia, period, who are currently utilizing a software package that does what you just stated?
Yes. I know I've talked to a couple of other sheriffs that they went together with their local law enforcement. I can't name them right off the top of my head, I forget who they are, but yes, and it's very, very capable of doing it. I mean, a lot of what I need, your police department needs, but what your police department might not need would be jail management software that I've got to have. But for them to have access to it, let's do it. Right now, they do, because I give them remote access to it. But it ought to be seamless across the board.
Instantaneous access to information, because those few seconds could be a lie.
Absolutely.
I'd be very interested in hearing more about this, Sheriff, and the software packages and what they do, maybe demonstrations of them.
Absolutely. We'll have to. I know I'm running out of time, but one last thing. The 2014 squash, you saw that equipment was there. Sheriff's office, cars and equipment have been in squash since 2014. And I would ask that if that's how they're going to be funded, then that could be continued as far as our squash dollars looking into the future. Okay? I thank you for your time. I greatly appreciate it. It's a great thing.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you,
sir.
I'd like you to ask that for less than $1 million. Thank you, sir. Dwayne Hill stuff you back here, the House Representative, the State House Representative. Do you want to stand up and say hi to everybody?
Your politician.
Thank you for coming, Dwayne. Now, that's state money. We've got here for a reason. If you hear anything y'all are funding, we need a little cash. Our next presenter is Donald Brown. He wanted some theme music.
Welcome.
You want somebody to hum a few bars? Randall, can you play some?
I'm not going to fill it at all.
He picked a Metallica song he wanted to come in to.
For those that don't know, I'm Russell Brown, Public Works Director. I want to talk specifically about our infrastructure and roads and bridges. Basically, I want to talk about where we have an inventory, a functional class. Functional class is important when you get to $4. Pay for life cycle. You know, every road has a life cycle. As we know, it has a beginning and end. I want to talk about current conditions, the state of our roads currently. I want to talk about TIP versus LMIG. TIP is a transportation improvement program through the federal government. And so that's important to know what the functional classes are. LMIG is state funding that we get each year. I'm going to talk about costs. Cost is what it costs us to pave a mile of road every year. Basically, pavement summary and bridges. In Catoosa County, in unincorporated areas, we have 427.4 center line miles. Now, when we're mowing, we have 840-something miles. So that's a lot of lane miles, a lot of center line miles. 99.9% of our roads are paved. We have 37 bridges, and of those 37 bridges, 9 of those bridges are posted, meaning that they have a weight limit. We have 2,286 culverts, the cross drains that go under everything. Those are cross drains that go under the roads. We inspect those every 2 years. So along with the culverts, we also inspect the roads every 3 years. This is, every road has a functional class. There's our interstates, our principal arterials, minor arterials, there are collector roads, rural and urban, and there's local roads. The majority of our roads are local, and they're either rural or urban. So the makeup right here is, so of those, of that hierarchy, 5.4% is urban minor. Urban minor meaning your Boynton drives, your Lakeview drives. Those are those roads. Urban collector roads are Bagot, Bailey Hills, Pine Grove. Rural major collectors, Bandy Road, Cherokee Valley Road. And then we have rural minor collectors. And when you start at rural minor collectors don't get any federal funding. So the only money that we get from the federal government are for the first three categories. So as you can see, most of our roads, local, urban local and rural local, make up 78% of our network. Lifecycle of the road. Basically, if the road, based on the conditions, once a road goes about 15 years, it starts to fail. It stays pretty linear until it gets into that last 25%. And then once it gets there, that road starts to deteriorate pretty quickly. And, you know, it used to be the mindset, well, you know, when I first started doing that, it's like, let's pay this road, because if we can pay this road now, it'll cost us a dollar. You know, four more years, it's going to cost us $4. So the mentality was, well, you know, we don't pay that yet. But the problem is, a lot of our roads, we're at a critical point because a lot of our roads are falling in this fair to support. They're fair and poor. And so if we don't react to that soon, the longer we wait, the more money it's going to cost. When I started doing this 7 years ago, we started doing pavement management. Basically, pavement management, we go out and we look at the road and we grade the road. And from a scale of 1 to 10, how many potholes and showers, the stripe and how wide it is, how long it is. There's a lot of categories involved. So when I talk, this overall pavement condition, right here at the end, is 94.7 miles of poor structural, they're we're rated as poor, needing structural improvement. If 94 miles. Today, that would cost $21 million to pay for. To pay and fix those. If you look at this, if you look at this histogram, this we're starting to get the longer that we wait to invest in this, the more roads that we're going to have that they're going to turn into that very, very poor conditions. And then that's where it costs, you know, $4 or $5 a mile. So basically, this is where I talk about CHIP versus LBAM. This is the funding that we get. It's outside of SPLOST. 88 miles of the 427 that we get qualify for federal funding. That's like, I think 21%. Basically, we've been focused on those 88 miles pretty good for the last 4 or 5 years because they were really bad conditions. Burning Bush. Burning Bush was one, Post Oak was one. We just did Bandy this year. We're looking at doing Boynton this year. We're looking at doing Cherokee Valley Road this year, Page Road this year. So those are the only roads that can, those 88 miles can qualify for the federal funding. The federal funding is really great because it's an 80-20 match. It's in a three-year cycle. Average daily traffic is over 5,000 cars a day. And right now, for the last 3 or 4 years, we've been paving about 10 to 12 miles on average. Of the other 339 centerline miles, mostly those are rural. We get out, the local maintenance improvement program is state fund that we get every year. This past year was about $650,000. It's a 70-30 match. Average daily traffic is less than 5,000. And right now, last 3 or 4 years, we've been paying about 3.5, 4.5 miles a year. When you look at, and I should have made the bottom a little bit bigger, when you look at how many miles we have, and you divide that by 20 years, because that's what you're thinking, that a road's going to last 20 years. So what I need to pay to maintain that 20 years is 21.35 miles a year. Well, 21.35 miles a year, that's about half of what I'm doing right now. So the price, it's expensive. This year, this is what we're doing this year. 2017 tip paving, we're doing 6.55 miles of going drive. That does include bridge. It goes all the way to the park, to Walker Jackson's. 5.64 miles of Cherokee Valley, 0.56 miles of Page Road, 0.59 miles of Greens Lake Road. The federal share was $2.2 million. The county share was $551. Total cost was $2.699 million. That's 202,000 miles per mile to do those roads. So that's how expensive it is. The LMA, the 2017, we're doing 2.97 miles of Tunnel Hill Road. State share was 681,205. The county share was 204,361. Total cost for Tunnel Hill Road is 695,000 miles. It's easy to forget that pavements are a community's single largest asset. The county has a major investment in its 427.4-mile roadway network. Simply considering the pavement surface alone, it will cost Cadiz County $106,850,000 in today's dollars to complete the repair and pave the existing pavement infrastructure. Pavements are not perpetual. They're one of the county's fastest deteriorating assets, due to environmental effects, increased traffic loading, and utility bills. Roadway funding will protect Catoosa's pavement assets, resulting in better overall roadway conditions and satisfaction that taxpayer dollars have been well spent. The biggest thing that I wanted everybody to understand was the state of our roads. I think we're getting close to a critical point where we have to invest more in our infrastructure as far as road goes and where we are, because I think we have some roads that are really starting to get really bad. And I saw an article last week where I think it was Franklin County, Alabama, where a guy was talking about how the revenues weren't meeting the investments, and they were starting to, the roads were so bad, they were just making gravel roads again. So, because there's no money. But that was the biggest points I wanted to make about the roads. Let's talk about bridges. And then we got to find money to put on these bridges. This is a bridge out in Houston Valley. It's a 5,000, the load limit on it is 5 tons. I know it's been 5 tons for several years, and you know, it's 5 tons right before they close. And that's a role that we're looking into right now, and we've got to bring that rating up. In 2012, we paved that road, and there was about 10 layers of asphalt on it, and we thought, well, if we take 10 layers of asphalt on it, maybe they'll send the load limit up, but they didn't. But right here is these are the 9 posted bridges that we have. Feline Creek is 17-ton. Yates Spring is 14-ton. And what I need you to remember is a bus weighs 13 tons. Okay? A school bus, empty driveway weighs 13 tons. Mount Vernon Road is 20 tons. Spivey Road is 14 tons. Swanson Road is 18 tons. House of Valley at Dry Creek is 5 tons. Houston Valley Road and Draft Creek, that's a bridge that's on down, that's 20 tons. And then there's a bridge on Cooper Road that's also 5 tons. Of the 37, these are the 9 that we had posted. Those are the 37, that's just basically a breakdown of each structure number. And basically what I'm doing on the bridges is I want to have a bridge, just like I have pavement management, where we inspect every road every 3 years. I need the same thing for bridges, where we keep those inspected. You know, obviously the state comes in and inspects these bridges on a 2-year cycle. So they used to, in 2013, they used to give a sheet to every. They always gave us a printout, a hard copy of the conditions, and then they quit doing that, and then they said you could get that information online, and so I don't think that when they started doing that, I don't think they were ready for it, but we do have access to that information now. Bridges, we are actually talking to some engineers right now about what we have to do to increase the ratings on the current bridges we have. As far as Houston Valley's 5, and Yates Springs, both of those are 14, and Houston Valley's 5 tons. And then develop an action plan for current conditions so what I need to know is I need them to look at every bridge that I got, what the recommended repairs are, and how do we put a budget together that fixes all these in a certain period of time. And then, basically just having developing a long-term strategy to ensure that structures are maintained safe in service, and that we, you know, when it's time to replace them, then it's time to replace them. But the infrastructure is something that affects the roads that we drive on, affects all of us, so it's important that we invest. Anybody have any questions?
Buster, I got a quick question for you. With on the roads, there's an inland port that the state is building up in Chatsworth. Do we have any indication what to expect as far as truck traffic goes on our Catoosa County roads?
Yeah, those should stay on state roads, state routes. They'll probably come out on the state route and they'll stay on the freeway. I doubt those will have any impact on our roads.
Sure you heard time and time again, excuse me, that
to think of economic development as an investment in your community. And that is very true, and it really plays itself out in the SPLOST component. As Mr. Henson put up on the screen, although we have put $6.7 million in the current SPLOST cycle, and that's 11.2% of the cycle, over the last 23 years, which encompasses all of the SPLOST cycles, we put 2.7% of our SPLOST money into economic development. One thing about economic development for a community like us is not only is it an investment, but it's one of the few categories of SPLOST where we can take some of the money we generate from a retail standpoint, being a strong retail community, and reinvest it and watch it grow more income and more SPLOST income that thereby reduces the benefit on property taxes, and everybody benefits. We're able to leverage our money when opportunities come our way, and I'll give you a couple of examples of how we've done that in the past. It also presents an opportunity for the county and the cities especially to work together on projects which we have done successfully in the past that benefit everyone. If we bring in a retailer that pays property taxes, obviously the schools benefit, the county, and if that retailer is located in the city shares in the property tax. We all share in the SPLOST revenue. 3 cents of every dollar comes back to all of us to divide for schools, for capital projects, and for rolling back the millage rate and the burden on the taxpayer. For retailers that locate in the cities will benefit alcohol tax if they sell alcohol, occupation tax, permit fees, franchise fees, and sewer and water revenues. There are direct and indirect benefits. One example of a way we can take SPLOST and invest in jointly in economic development projects is the project between the Development Authority and the City of Ringgold. That project, which was a raw piece of land, ended up partnering. The city put in the water, the sewer, the county put in a road, and we have not only a college campus to be very proud of, but also the retail and soon-to-be healthcare that springs up around it. Another example that I'll give you with Fort Oglethorpe and the Development Authority partnered together, I can tell you this is a very specific example of how you can stretch your dollars and the return on your investment, because we had to track the revenues to be sure that we were getting the revenues that the developer guaranteed. And that's the project that resulted in the development of Buffalo Wild Wings, Marshalls, for a $700,000 investment that was divided equally between the city of Fort Oglethorpe and the county. In the first year, we generated $602,000. Property taxes and sales taxes. In the second year alone, we generated over $200,000 in property taxes. I didn't track the sales tax because the developer had met his obligations. So you can see these dollars will go very far. Another example is what we call Project Hilltop 2, which many of you will recognize as Cabela's. For a $2 million investment from the County and Development Authority, we generated $583,000 of sales and property taxes in year one, $693,000 in year two. And that doesn't include what's been generated so far in 2017. So for the next SPLOST cycle, we've got $6.7 million in the current cycle. Mr. Henson tells me that we have this $2 million from our Project Hilltop 2 or Cabela's project that we'll need to put in the next cycle. I hope that the county and both cities will consider funding economic development at the same level, at least in the next cycle, as we have this cycle, because it gives us an opportunity. If we bring in more retailers or bring in more manufacturers, that just increases the amount of taxes that we get in the cycle. I'll be happy to answer any questions anybody might have about this or any other project, but that's all I have.
Any questions? Thank you, Chair. This time we'll move on to our city portion. Ms. Giddy, City Manager, Laura.
Well, Jay, when you give your Oscar acceptance speech, you picture the long music starts.
So thank you all so much for hosting this meeting tonight. I think this is a great opportunity for us to have a good dialogue and a good conversation about the importance of SPLAS to our county. Before I get started, I would like to say thank you to Police Chief Mike Hubbard and our city attorney, Rob Stoltz, as well as our director of Streets, Parks, and Rec, Jeff Long, for attending this meeting this evening. I'm honored to represent the mayor and city council of Fort Overlord to discuss our upcoming capital outlay projects that may be funded by 2019 SPLAS. There are a couple of ways in which a county may distribute SPLAS allocations, and one way is through an intergovernmental agreement. Another way is without an intergovernmental agreement, and I think we can be proud to say that really since SPLAS 1, we have operated under an intergovernmental agreement, which encourages cities and counties to achieve success when we all work together and cooperate to come up with the best solution for our community. So I'm going to go right into our 2019 SPLAS priorities. Our priorities are to construct, replace, improve, and expand capital outlay projects in order to comply with the requirements of the Chattanooga Interjurisdictional Agreement with the City of Fort Overlord for the maintenance and treatment of sewage. Also, to provide the right vehicles and equipment for our public safety departments to best protect the community. Another priority is to improve public facilities and infrastructure and to encourage economic development within Coosa County. The interjurisdictional agreement between the City of Chattanooga, Tennessee, and the City of Fort Overlord, Georgia, for the treatment and disposal of wastewater by Chattanooga from Fort Overlord, our previous agreement expired in May of 2017. So our new agreement has additional requirements that weren't in our previous agreement due to a consent decree that the City of Chattanooga is operating under with the EPD. Currently, we are working on completing a capacity management, operation, and maintenance program self-assessment, a sanitary sewer evaluation study work plan, including flow monitoring. That has actually been drafted, and once it's approved by the City of Chattanooga, we will be responsible for implementing those fixes for our system. And actually, SPLAS funds and 2014 SPLAS are being used to make those improvements. There are several other requirements of the Chattanooga Intergovernmental Agreement, and it really does, it impacts all of us. So it's something to watch. I think the City of Greenville's agreement has a few more years than ours did, but pretty soon they'll be under the same agreement. So the highlighted areas on this map show three sewer sheds and the wastewater flow monitoring work plan. The City of Fort Overlord maintains the sewer lines in these three sheds in Coosa County and operates sewer stations within that area. 2014 SPLAS funds have been dedicated to make improvements to the West Chickamauga Basin in blue. With 2014 SPLAS funds, we have improved Cloud Springs Road Sewer, Scruggs Road Sewer, and we're now working on Highway 41 Phase 1 and pump station upgrades. This is another map from our draft flow monitoring work plan, showing sewer subbasins. The subbasins each have approximately the same length of pipe, and flow monitors will measure the flow within each subbasin. This will help us identify specific areas for improvement. Per the intergovernmental agreement with the City of Chattanooga, the system that we maintain within Coosa County may not exceed 186,250 gallons per hour as a flow rate on a moving hourly average. We looked at the data from previous 12 months, and every month except one, we exceeded that maximum flow rate. So essentially what that means for our customers is that a 15% surcharge will be applied to our water and sewer bills anytime we exceed that 186,250 gallons per hour for the entire month. To fix this flow rate, solutions are expensive. We have options to rehabilitate the system. When we recently visited with the city of Chattanooga, one of their experts mentioned that they didn't really see how we would rehabilitate our way out of this issue, and that we may want to look at constructing a storage facility for sewage that would allow us to control the rate at which it's released into Chattanooga's system. And again, all of these things are possible, and these solutions are possible because of SPLOST. So far this year, we've purchased 33 tasers with 2014 SPLOST funds for $62,826. And for the 2019 SPLOST, we would like to propose the purchase of 31 body cameras. Cameras are not available in our police vehicles. Also, to replace our 800 megahertz radios, which we have started that replacement cycle with the current SPLOST. 25 marked patrol vehicles at 5 per year. The total cost is $710,000. Replace 4 fire engines, replace 2 ladder trucks, and already we're over $5 million in capital outlay projects. Another priority is to upgrade our water distribution system. These pictures show what can happen when a PVC pipe bursts. This actually happened on 2A in front of the movie theater, and you can see the impact that it also had on our roadways, the picture on the right. So it's necessary for us to go back and replace PVC water mains with ductile iron pipe. In the 2014 SPLOST and the 2019 SPLOST, we would like to upgrade the 50-year-old PVC water distribution system on Edgewood and Pinewood. We'd also like to install a valve and emergency water connection to Catoosa to distribute water in an emergency. Additionally, we would like to upgrade the automated meter readers. Currently, we're at about 52% of this upgrade to automated readers, and that estimated cost is about $320,000 to finish. Stormwater is a big issue for us in the city of Fort Oglethorpe. That's going to be, it has been and will continue to be a big focus for SPLOST funding. It's hard to see that bottom picture on the right, but you can actually see this is an example of where paving and repaving our roads have resulted in some instances of the curb is at the same level or maybe even lower than the road is. So, you know, that's a problem that we need to look at finding solutions to fix. So milling and paving streets is one answer. Working with an engineer to find solutions to eliminate structure and roadway flooding, and of course, acquire easements in the process in order to make those improvements. We'd also like to upgrade public facilities. Our playground equipment at the Gilbert Stevenson Park, a very popular park in the city of Fort Oglethorpe, has equipment that's currently over 20 years old, and it needs to be replaced for safety purposes. We're estimating about $500,000 to make that replacement. We'd also like to replace the fencing around the perimeter of ball fields and reconfigure City Hall to better meet the needs of residents, business owners, and other visitors. The cost is to be determined. It's actually currently under conceptual design. And finally, we look forward to partnering with all of you to encourage economic development in our community. Phase one of the sanitary sewer expansion project is highlighted in yellow. We are currently in the engineering phase of that, and it should be ready to put out to construction bid probably within the next month or so. The area in pink shows additional phases that we hope to get to in the near future with additional SLOSS funding. We also plan to invest in a historic corridor that's the Lafayette Road by improving the streetscape to encourage visitors to stay and explore the area rather than just get from one end to the other as quickly as possible. Currently, we have a $3 million grant from the Appalachian Regional Commission to install landscape medians, ADA compliant sidewalks, crosswalks, and other important features. However, we will need additional money for benches, things like benches and lighting and waste receptacles and things that really create place in a streetscape environment. This is a larger map to help y'all visualize the sewer system improvements on that. I showed you the expansion, phase one and phase two. This map shows, hopefully you can see this, the yellow is phase one of our sewer expansion project. The light blue is proposed as phase two. And the navy blue would be phase three. And of course, all of these things require engineering, easement acquisition, and construction. We estimate this in all three phases to cost approximately $3 million. This is a project that we're currently working on. It's truly a joint capital outlay project with Coosa County. And we're excited that the county actually purchased the building with SLOSS funding and has designated over $350,000 in funding from the 2014 SLOSS to help with renovations for this building. The total cost of the gym renovation is over $600,000. So the city of Fort Worth will look at using some of our designated SLOSS funds to complete that renovation. Of course, the renovation doesn't include things like equipment, bleachers, and things like that, so we'll need to identify those funds. So thank you for the opportunity to share our collective priorities, and this is a terrific platform for sharing information. Anybody have any questions?
Another thing, and Chad's already stole my thunder, College Park. the city of Greenville did water and sewer. It was a joint project between Catoosa County and the EDA. That's looking back towards where the Zaxby's is in Hamilton. Medical is building there on College Park Drive. This is actually facing back towards the actual Georgia Northwestern Technical College. If you've not had an opportunity to go in that, it's amazing. The enrollment is doing very, very well, and we're proud to see it continue to grow. Another project that was funded by SPLOSH is our Copper Spring Well. And Randall, I believe it was cold that day.
It was.
If I'm not mistaken, it was very, very cold. And Bob Atkins, the geologist actually, that found those funny looking rocks, and he got all excited and come in my office and said, "Look what I found." And I thought, "We're paying you this kind of money to go out and find little pebbles." He said, "Oh, you don't understand. There's water under these rocks." Well, he was right. That's 1.5 million gallons a day of crystal clear water. And they ran it for days on day, and it never slowed out. So we're proud to do that. We'll be talking about that a little bit more here in a few minutes. Another project, Highway 41 and Chapman Road turn lanes. If anybody goes down through there, hopefully you've seen what's happened. Very nice project. Again, a joint city, county, and state funded project. The state of Georgia through Senator Mullis and our state representative was able to get $350,000 to help with this project, and it has turned out very well. This is on Chapman Road, and what you see here is the first ever right-hand turn and then a left-hand turn. So many years, one car would get there wanting to turn left, and everybody else just had to wait. Well, we've resolved that. We're proud to do that. If any of you, and I know the sheriff has been involved in this many times, when Chapman Road and a flash flood with flood, never failed. You need emergency vehicles to go back there, but you got a problem. 41 Highway is also flooded. So now, how do you get to it? Well, you have to go almost to East Ridge and come back in the upper road. Since this stormwater system has been put in place, there's been zero flash floods. And I believe the weatherman said that we've had several flash floods already in the, you know, since it's opened up. So we feel very confident this is going to handle the majority of those flash floods. Caney Lane Extension. Many of you know we have Highway 151 widening projects right up on us. You see the equipment, you see the barrels. We're fixing to go through a whole lot of fun. Well, we had two roads. We had Caney Lane and we had Old Pollard Road. They lacked about 1,000 feet touching. My mayor and council, we talked about it for a number of years. And then we started talking to the county, and then the utility district jumped in there and extended a water bank, 1,000 feet of pavement and the infrastructure. Now those two roads are opened up. That's the other end there, Pollard Road. And what do you see? You already see economic development, Chad, going there on it. You see land clearing. We're seeing property even on Pollard Road starting to change hands with people that have a lot of ambition in doing some economic development. We see this as like South Harris in East Ridge off of I-24. Another project that was a joint project was Barber Bridge. And this was something Mayor Barber had wanted to do for a number of years. And after 40 years, we were able to do this. And on the left is the list of county commissioners that was in office during the funding of that. And this is a picture, actually, of the bridge. So what was the city of Ringo charged with in 2013? And Carl did, as always, a great job showing where a lot of those funds were expended. In 2003, we were handed a 1998 plan, sewer study, that showed all these different areas that needed to be sewered. One of them at the very top was the Morris Estate subdivision that had to be completely rehabilitated. And I know that Buster Brown was just walking around because he is so at ease and just felt right at home. I think it might have had something to do with he couldn't see like I can't see. And then you've got Meadow Green and you've got Graysville Road area, which was a lot of the Indian Springs, and then you have Leon Estates, Remont Estates. Over here, we have Foster Hill subdivision up on, they're close to the interstate. Blevins Estates, which has been sewered, and then Townsend Estates, Townsend Place, Melody Estates, and then what we call Fremont Road, below, between Boynton Drive and Battlefield Parkway. You say, well, what is that? That represents a little over 1,000 citizens that now have access to sewer. Sometimes we get asked the question, well, why is that important? And the best way I can describe it, when you go out and you talk to hundreds of people for sewer easements over the years, when somebody has spent their entire life working hard and trying to do the right thing, the largest asset that most of us wind up with is what? It's our home. And to see the pain in people's eyes when they can't flush their toilet, or they can't have custody, or they can't have company over it because it would overload their fill lines, or they carry their laundry to the laundry man to do their laundry because they don't have a working fill line. So that's what I guess what makes it important to me is, yeah, you put sewer through a 100-lot subdivision that's been there for 30 years, and 20 or 30 of them put on. What about the others? Well, the other ones, a lot of times, are just lucky. They're lucky because maybe their house sits up on a little bit of a hill. Well, we all know what water table is, right? It's under the ground. So where is their fill line water going? Maybe it's going to that other property that can't flush. So this has given a lot of promise to areas, and we're seeing a lot of people connecting on. We're actually seeing a lot of lots that sit there for years that would not perk. Now we're seeing people building homes on them. So they've been paying property taxes on a vacant lot that was really worthless to them. Maybe they just mowed it to have something where to park, an RV or something of that nature. Now it's an asset to them. So I guess that's why it makes it important for me. This particular map is one that Jim Walker had asked me to show. He said, I know what you're going to do. He's right. This is the House Bill 489 map, the Service Delivery Strategy map. It's in our Joint Comprehensive Plan. And, Port Oakville, y'all know that I was born and raised on the west side of the county. I love you guys. But Ringo has everything from this line all the way east. So when you look at Carl's numbers and you see $40 million, plus that money has been put into these areas here in the unincorporated areas of Petusa County for the purpose of sewer expansion. Let's talk about a few of the projects. This is one that has not been done yet that was handed to us in 2003 by the Parkway Estates. This is one that we feel like needs to be done. We have Heritage High School and Heritage Middle School down here. The red is Posto, the blue is Three Knots, and then you have the Boynton Ballfields up here. That would open up a basin that could really use some, that could stand some growth. But one thing that we see is we'd be able to take the Heritage High School and Heritage Middle School off of those pump stations where currently they're pumping back over into a different basin and put them on gravity so that they would not have that ongoing maintenance and expense of maintaining those expensive pump stations. So that's one project that we see very important. Another particular area that was on the 98 study that was handed to us in 2003 is the Scenic Hills, Edgeman Highlands, and the Fox Bend subdivision. And that's behind the racetrack there near I-75. Another area in the Ringo Basin, everything so far been in the Pima Basin, is this is the Highway 151 South. The green area at the top is Rollins Industrial Park, and we're talking about extending that line to about the Yates Roadhill area. This is a smaller option, and this would be option B, which would pretty much just go there from the industrial park down to that Luttrell Lane area, and I think this might be Misty Ridge subdivision over here. Trying to give you some, just some ballpark numbers. We had one of our engineering firms give us some estimates based on a sort of a windshield type review there. You can see that. And by the way, Board of County Commissioners, I'll be giving you a copy of a lot of this information so you'll have it. And then this is one project that we actually partnered in, and we had talked about the possibility of trying to get some funding in the next squash. So I guess it's time to talk about that. Chapman Road is a $932,000 project, DOT, like I said earlier. We were fortunate to get $350,000 from the state, leaving the local share $582,000. If we split that, it would be about, what is it, $281,000 or $291,000? And then the city portions, we just would like to pretty much continue what we've done in the past, with the exception of water tank for the industrial park, for fire protection and for other type issues, and then the development of the Popper Springs groundwater well. Jenny talked about the importance of the city of Chattanooga and what we're seeing there. You know, with nearly a $300 million consent decree handed down by EPA, that's becoming just a huge issue for the city of Chattanooga. All of our wastewater, 404 Van Ringo's, goes to Moxon Beam, and they're the ones that's having to handle all this. So when we're having discussions, and I'm sure 404's had the same discussion, they'll ask, well, what is your sewer rates? Well, when I tell them what our sewer rates are, somewhere less than $4 a thousand, he laughs and says, well, ours is over 10. I can't imagine having to pass along that type of $1,000 rate to our customers. So that third bullet there is extremely important, and that's sewer infill infiltration, trying to limit rainwater from getting into our system. It's not anything warm and fuzzy to talk about, but I want to tell you, cripple system. And then you get the moratoriums where all of this wonderful great systems that we've got out here, wonderful, but you can't hook anybody on. So we're trying to avoid that and try to reinvest in those systems. Water line upgrades, vehicles, just similar to what everybody else has talked about, street improvements and recreation. Any questions? I tried to hurry it because Jim told me I had 10 minutes. And I did want to say thank you, Chairman, for putting this together and all the county staff. They've been very, very kind to do so. No questions?
Thank you, Dan. And you've never done anything in 10 minutes.
I told him, I said, I'm slow. It takes me 5 minutes this way.
Thank you, Chairman. It's not all the agenda, but we're fortunate to have our official utility here with us. And I just want to give that the house out of water line. So you can, or you can, however you want to.
I'll just stay here because I just work here. We're in the middle of this project. We're about a year into the 24-inch water main will bring at this time 6 million gallons a day in from the Eastside Utility District. This is finished water ready to use. We hope to have it completed in June of next year. It's going real well. We've hit, you know, some roadblocks here and there, but everything's going good on that. So hopefully with that 6 million a day, and then right now I'm pulling about 4.5 million a day out of Yates Springs, which we hope that keeps it up. And we also have another connection with the Tennessee American that we can pull about 2.5 million gallons a day. So hopefully if we can keep all this going, there'll be enough water coming into the county for upgrades, you know, economic development, because we've not only got to keep enough drinking water, we've got to keep enough fire protection water, which, you know, requires a lot. We're looking at adding some more storage tanks when you get this in, you don't know exactly what the elevation will be. But it's come along, so hopefully one day we'll have that in. And if something does happen to the H spring, you'll just start a pump and everybody still have water. The pump station will bring six now with addition of one more pump. I can bring 9 million gallons a day through that line in this county. So hopefully with that and with our, you know, one thing as a county, we have to be very fortunate that we have actually two tie-ins into the Tennessee River. We have one through the Eastside Utility District and one through Tennessee America. We're in the same Tennessee River Basin as they are. So that way they're permitted to let us have any amount of water we want without having to get, you know, any big permits or anything, because it's all in the same basin. As the cities just said, we started that Alabama Highway Road project today, so we'll be moving water line and everything down through there, and that's about 1.8 that we're going to have to spend down there to reduce some water lines and stuff. And I talked with Jim and some of the boys at the fire department, and we're trying to look at, we build a lot of these old subdivisions that don't have, the water lines is not big enough for them for fire protection. You know, they've got drinking water, but they don't have fire protection. So we're looking at trying to work some more with them and get into those areas and replace the water lines in those subdivisions where they will have fire protection. So we've got quite a few of those areas that need it. And we've got some areas that don't have, that the main is big enough, but back when they were installed, they didn't install fire hydrants. So we're looking at trying to just install some fire hydrants in different areas to make sure that everybody's got fire protection. So that's about where we're at.
Thank you all for being here. Thank you for that update. We're very fortunate to have a secondary source of water in Atlanta like it's happening.
Yeah, but we're
not going to accept
it. You're working as a dealer.
Try it.
Thank you all for making that. All right. At this time, we're going to go to comments. I'm going to start to my right, and then the mayor of the city council will bring you on to go further. If y'all have any comments, feel free. Watch our microphone.
I think that's awful. In any event, Mr. Mayor, Chairman, and Vice Chairman, thank you so much for allowing us to come together in this forum. I think we've heard that there are a tremendous number of needs across the county that these boards have been looking at trying to fulfill in the coming months as we look at our SPOS initiative coming up. I think one of the other key areas, and Buster tied into the need for transportation improvement throughout our county and our cities, we are facing the same issues with the roads that Buster mentioned, but I do believe that this is not alone in Cochise County. I think that we'll find that Walker County and Chattooga County and Dade County are also facing these same problems, and I think there's some opportunities that our state representatives and state senators working together in the legislature have allowed us an opportunity to come together in the future and find other ways to solve some of the money problems of this, and I think we should seriously look at those options from a county perspective, and it was possible, but those are more county oriented things. But obviously $121 million, I believe, is the number that Buster mentioned. We could work very hard with the next SPOS, the SPOS after that, and everything else we could come up with money for, and we're not going to meet the need. So we're going to find ways to do that. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I'd like to say thank you for having me. I think we've all seen the needs in each department. I was delighted to hear Dina as she went through hers. I brag on Cochise County everywhere I go in the state. If you don't think we live in paradise up here, go south, visit some of these, and I hear these people, we don't have any of that. we are very fortunate up here with the amenities we do have for the people, our county. They have been so good to help fund all this, to help us pull it in. And once you get here, you have to take care of it. And it's very important that we continue this. And I commend y'all on what you're doing. And we say thank you for helping us do it.
I had a quick comment. Our city manager, Dan Wright, talked about the Chapman Road project. And I wanted to take a minute and elaborate on that just before the 5-1 county board. When it first came out, I think we discussed that, and some county board members that have since left and others have got elected. So Dan had covered that, and what when we initially set that up, because we felt like the Chapman Road project was so important, because those of you that know, when you turn there to Sonic, and we got that low area on Chapman Road, when we had the flash flood situations, and that would be completely impassable. And it also, because of flash flooding, 41 Highway would be impassable too. So we were in a situation where that we had that matching grant, but we had a deadline on what we needed to do to build that road up and put that bridge in that raised that elevation to allow more of that flash flood water to bypass under that new bridge to stop the flooding, quite frankly, from taking place on Chapman and backing up and flooding 41. And it's the flash flooding that's what caused those situations. So as a result of that, we had the engineers and the different ones tell us what we needed to do to solve that problem. And back during that time, we felt like we did have the matching state grant, and we had an agreement with the county to where that we would all join together, like all of us have been talking about working together, to where that we could alleviate that problem. Because, and I think this is important, that was such a serious problem with flooding, and even though it's in the city of Ringo, it was a flash flooding situation that affected not only our Ringo residents, but a number of our county residents, because as most of you know, when you turn 41 Chapman Road, that is the main way that most people go to the Canyon Cove Creekview area, which is in the city. As you continue on out Chapman Road, that goes to a lot of the areas there at the end of Chapman and on through there, county residents. So we, because of our deadline, and we chose to go ahead and proceed, because I think at the time there were some discussions with the county, and myself and Dan Wright met with some of you, and we discussed that early on. And I know there were some limitations on some funding at the county level and some concern, so we had to make the decision as our city government authority, even though that match was not there currently, to go ahead with that and complete the project so that we did not lose that state funding. So we as a board felt like that was important to go on and complete that project by our deadline. So what we would ask going forward, and the county was gracious enough back when we talked about it very professionally to discuss some options with some future SPLOST money and things that were forthcoming. So as Dan had put on the chart up there, we respectfully ask that as the county 5-man board goes forward, and Mr. Henson, and the attorney, and county manager, and others, that we would respectfully ask that please consider us go forward thinking how important that project was for us to complete for not only city residents, but also county residents, and also as sheriff and chief help and all others know that the also flooding really limits our emergency response to those areas going to and from. So we felt like that was very important. So I'd like to ask that please consider that on that matching amount that we discussed a few minutes back.
Time and time again, since I've been on the council, the county is in a position sometimes where they are dealing with competing interests within the county. And I just appreciate the way you guys handle that. You're so willing to work with us on project after project after project. And I'm not going to try to lay them all out here, but just, you know, recently Chapman Road, you threw in a lot of money into that. We're trying to put in a bridge for our pedestrian crossing, and you partnered with us on that. And I'm just so thankful for you guys, and the way that you go about your business and try to handle those competing interests the best that you can. And so I see that continuing to happen moving forward, and I'm very thankful with how you guys handle that. Thank you for this opportunity to do this, and it's good to get an idea of some of the things that you guys have going on and the city of Little Lord has going on. That's all I have. Thank you.
You want to ask something? Earl, City of Portland, any comments?
Mr. Chapman.
Thank you for having this. It's very informative. What I see is the best to come. We all have the same issues, all the cities and counties across the state and even the United States. But what I think I've seen since I've been in this in 2 years is things are going good for Tewksbury County. We've got a great school system. Thank you, Mr. Bates. We do. We've got a great sheriff, the police. I'm thankful for everything we have. And like I said, I still think we have the best to come. Thank you.
I echo what Jim said about the education. I recently wrote Brown and Dalton from George Washington, who already have this one down here. So it's a lot of endless opportunities for our country to go into this.
I'm really thankful for the opportunity to do this. Thank you, Steve, for putting this together. I think that cooperation is really important, and a lot of us in the room know each other and have gotten along really well. And it's nice to get together and see this stuff as a team, because it kind of brings it into a whole new light, and I really appreciate this. I hope we'll do this again in the future.
Steve, we started talking about this in January, and I'm glad it finally came through conception. I hope that we will take advantage of this to do, again, that we may network so that each individual entity can come together, present their obstacles and opportunities so that we can maximize our capital and work together, that we don't duplicate efforts, but we actually combine and join our forces. So I'd like to propose that we do this again, maybe quarterly, if not every other month, so that we can stay in touch and get updates from those who spoke this evening. And that way we're all aware of the areas of concern.
Hopefully tonight, between Dana and Mr. Wright and Jenny, I hope y'all see how important this pen is. And, you know, it's going to be coming up on the ballot, and it always has some opposition. So, y'all seen firsthand what it does. You've seen what it's done for our school. I think you've seen what it has done for these cities and this county. So, I would just ask that when it comes up, that you remember this and share this with people, especially those that have a negative opinion of it. Because, although it's called lost, we wouldn't be lost to that, because we got to have it. I just hope that y'all keep that in mind and help us promote it. You've done a fantastic job the last time. And share that information with everybody. When you hear anything negative, try to overcome it. Hey, if you realize you wouldn't have this if it wasn't for that people. So just keep that in mind.
I'd just like to say, I guess going last, I get to be the broken record sounds, but thank you again, Mr. Chairman and the rest of the board commissioners, bringing this together. Got some good people down there to bring up. Terry, good to see you tonight, buddy. But again, it's very important that, you know, because we get in our day-to-day things dealing with our city, doing our things that you don't see outside the box, and you see right there, and it's good to hear what other people have done with the SPLOSH, the other agencies, the other members of Coosa County that makes it great. Growing up here, I tell everybody, this is the greatest community that I've ever seen. I mean, I've loved it. I had the best childhood. And it was because of people, some people still involved, but people before us that never get that started. Now it's even, raising two boys here, it's even it's even impressive the future that we got. I mean, thank you to YouTube. I'm able to help my son with homework because of the technology and the way it's great, you know, and it's just going to be impressive, and it's just great to be a part of it and raising a family here. And thank you again for bringing us all together so we can all do it together.
Commissioner, do you have any comments?
Well, Mr. Chairman, I just want to thank you for having this gathering tonight, and I echo the sentiments of both Corporal Thorpe and Ringo. I want to thank all the elected officials who are here, Catoosa Utility District, the school board. Good to see you guys here. You are important for economic development. I don't think we should ever lose sight on that. And I like to echo what Mayor Gray said. SPOS, as you saw, is extremely important. It's important to the county. It's important to all the different offices in the county. And also to echo what Mr. Crawford said when he mentioned that what makes Catoosa County different is the fact that we all do work together. It takes a team, it takes Fort Overthorpe, Rainbow, and Catoosa to work together to make this one of the best counties that we can make it for our families and our citizens to live in. So again, I include the school board in that as well. So thank you all for coming, and Chairman, thank you for hosting this. Hope you do it again.
Winners. I thought you had about 20 minutes to speak.
Good job. I would like to thank everyone here for coming tonight. All the school board, the water board, everyone. And this, it takes a big group of all of us working together. And as some said, I would like to see it maybe on a quarterly basis. And some that might not know, but Chattanooga through our PPO, there's a Strive 2055, 16 counties out of three states. They're estimating Catoosa County is going to be the largest growing county out of the 16. And they're saying that our population is going to grow like 147%. So seeing the goals, especially with the cities of infrastructure, the water company doing that, we've got to do that today. We can't wait till 2050 and say, hey, we've got to do something. We've got to have a meeting down to the school board. You know, so it takes us all doing that. And I would like to also see the two cities and the county maybe unify our building codes and our floodplains and all, where everything, want to make it friendly for the developers when they come in. You've got the same rules and laws when you come in Fort Overthorpe, Catoosa County, or Ringo. So maybe that'd be something that our planning zone and everyone would work towards doing that. That's it.
I want to spend just a minute on the thank our staff that we have and our constitutional officer. Well, we're going to finish out the year. It looks like, I believe it's a little over $1 million to the good, 1.6, I think, to the favorable in our budget. And I think that's great. That's a testament to how we have good stewards in our county. Our elected officials, our sheriff, Tracy, Judge Holder, everybody. Well, it's a group effort to make all this happen. But very thankful we have the group we have, the leadership we have. I've been impressed with each one of these men. I've enjoyed working with the cities. Again, our staff is phenomenal. I appreciate all they do. Thank everyone for taking the time to be here. Very informative. I'd love to do it on a quarterly basis. We can get a little deeper in the workings of things. If there's projects that anybody's want to talk about or things we want to join together on, we'll spend a little more time doing that. There's no other comments?